Good morning, everybody. It's Friday morning yet again, and we are just going to read God's Word together, just streaming from the body of Strain Church this morning. So let's read together Acts chapter 21. After saying farewell to the Ephesian elders, we sailed straight to the island of Kos. The next day we reached Rhodes and went to Patara, while we boarded a sailing ship for Phoenicia. We sighted the island of Cyprus, passed it on our left, and landed in the harbour of Tyre in Syria, where the ship was to unload its cargo. We went ashore and found local believers and stayed with them for a week. These believers prophesied through the Holy Spirit that Paul should not go on to Jerusalem. When we returned to the ship at the end of the week, the entire congregation, including women and children, left the city and came to the shore with us. There we knelt, prayed, and said our farewells. Then we went aboard and they returned home. The next stop after leaving Tyre was Ptolemais, where we were greeted with the brothers and sisters and stayed for one day. The next day we went on to Caesarea and stayed at the home of Philip the evangelist, one of the seven men who had been chosen to distribute food. He had four unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. Several days later, a man named Agabus, who also had the gift of prophecy, arrived from Judea. He came over, took Paul's belt, and bound his own feet and hands with it. Then he said, "The Holy Spirit declares, so shall the owner of this belt be bound by the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem and turned over to the Gentiles." When we heard this, we and the local believers all begged Paul not to go to Jerusalem. But he said, "Why all this weeping? You are breaking my heart. I am ready not only to be jailed at Jerusalem, but even to die for the sake of the Lord Jesus." When it was clear we couldn't persuade him, he gave up and said, "The Lord's will be done." After this, we packed our things and left for Jerusalem. Some believers from Caesarea accompanied us, and they took us to the home of Mason, a man originally from Cyprus and one of the early believers. When we arrived, the brothers and sisters in Jerusalem welcomed us warmly. The next day, Paul went with us to meet with James, and the elders of the Jerusalem church were also present. After greeting them, Paul gave a detailed account of the things that God had accomplished among the Gentiles through his ministry. After hearing this, they praised God, and then they said, "You know, dear brothers, how many thousands of Jews have also believed, and they all follow the law of Moses very seriously. But the Jewish believers here in Jerusalem have been told that you are teaching all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn their backs on the law of Moses. They've heard that you teach them not to circumcise their children or follow other Jewish customs. What should we do? They will certainly hear that you have come. Here's what we want you to do. We have four men here who have completed their vows. Go with them to the temple and join them in the purification ceremony, paying for them to have their heads ritually shaved. Then everyone will know that the rumours are all false and you yourself observe Jewish laws. As for the Gentile believers, they should do what we've already told them in a letter. They should abstain from eating food offered to idols, from consuming blood or the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality." So Paul went to the temple the next day with the other men. They had already started the purification ritual, so he publicly announced the date when their vows would end and sacrifice would be offered for each of them. The 7 days were almost ended when some of the Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul in the temple and roused a mob against him. They grabbed him, yelling, "Men of Israel, help us. This is the man who preaches against our people everywhere and tells everyone to disobey the Jewish laws. He speaks against the temple. He even defiles its holy place by bringing in Gentiles." For earlier that day, they had seen him in the city with Timaeus, a Gentile from Ephesus, and they assumed Paul had taken him into the temple. The whole city was rocked by these accusations, and a great riot followed. Paul was grabbed, dragged out of the temple, and immediately the gates were closed behind him. As they were trying to kill him, word reached the commander of the Roman regiment that all Jerusalem was in an uproar. He immediately called out his soldiers and officers and rang down among the crowd. When the mob saw the commander and the troops coming, they stopped beating Paul. Then the commander arrested him and ordered him bound with two chains. He asked the crowd who he was and what he had done. Some shouted one thing and some another. Since they couldn't find out the truth in all the uproar and confusion, he ordered that Paul be taken to the fortress. So Paul reached the stairs, and the mob grew so violent the soldiers had to lift him on their shoulders to protect him. And the crowd followed him, shouting, "Kill him, kill him." As Paul was about to be taken inside, he said to the commander, "May I have a word with you?" "Do you know Greek?" the commander asked, surprised. "Aren't you the Egyptian who led the rebellion some time ago, who took 4,000 members of the assassins out into the desert?" "No," Paul replied. "I am a Jew and a citizen of Tarsus in Cilicia, which is an important city. Please, let me talk to these people." The commander agreed. So Paul stood on the stairs and motioned for the people to be quiet. Soon a deep silence enveloped the crowd, and he addressed them in their own language, Aramaic. Amen. The end of Acts chapter 21. Again, an interesting chapter, a lot going on in it with Paul and his journey. He's finding himself in a sticky situation again. He's in a bit of bother. But when he came to Jerusalem and he gave an account of all that God had done through his ministry, as it says, the people praised God. The people recognized, the Jewish leaders recognized, that it wasn't Paul who had done this work. Yes, he was the tool, but this was the work of God. How often do we forget to thank God and to praise God? How often do we forget it's God that's working through us and in us, and not us? Actually, the Lord. And we need to stop, reflect on that, and give thanks to God. So let's do that this morning, on Friday morning. Let's reflect and give thanks to God for all that he has done, all that he continues to do, and asking for him to be with us through this weekend. Let's pray together. Father, thank you again for another glorious day. It is glorious because you have given it to us, Lord. It's not just because there's sunshine outside, but this is a day given to us by you, a day that you have blessed, a day that you have given us so much already. Father, thank you. Thank you for all your goodness to us, for all that you give to us, for just your constant presence with us. Lord, thank you that you use us in your plan, for your will and for your future. It just amazes us, Lord, that you want to use us, because we are feeble, we are broken, we are flawed, and yet you love us and you care for us. Father, thank you. And be with us this weekend, Lord, as we again try to cope with lockdown, as we again meet in different ways right way around this world. Just may you be in the midst of all that goes on, that we would know a real sense of your presence, your peace and blessing. So Lord, thank you. Continue with us today, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you, folks, for joining with me. I'll not be here tomorrow morning, Saturday, a day off. Sunday morning, be back at 11 o'clock streaming, and it'll then also go up on our YouTube channel as well. So in the meantime, have a lovely weekend, stay safe, and may you know God's peace and blessing. Take care, folks. Bye.